Yeah. Hello, everyone. Very pleased you could join us today. My name is Olga Piwat, and I'm a researcher of iFi Global. As you can see, today we're presenting the second NET Forum in 2021, focusing upon the work we are currently doing on our fund governance data hub and director selection. I am now going to pass you over to Simon, who is going to present our findings. He's going to talk for about 20 minutes, and then we would like to take some questions. If you'd like to ask a question, please refer to the Q&A button at the bottom of the screen. We'll try to answer all your questions by the end of the presentation. Thank you for your attention, and now over to Simon.
Thank you very much, Olga. I'm very pleased it was Olga that gave the introduction today, because she's working very closely indeed with us on the development of the data hub that I'm going to be referring to a lot in the next few minutes. And thank you all very much for joining us. I'm very pleased to see that we have people following this presentation in pretty much all the main international fund jurisdictions. For example, Cayman, Guernsey, Jersey, Ireland, and Luxembourg, as well as, of course, some people in both the US and the UK. This is an update of, to a certain extent, it's an update of what we touched upon in the NED Forum in late January, but there's been a number of developments to that, which is what we're going to be really focusing upon today. Our data hub has come a long way in the last 5 or 6 weeks, but still has some way to go. Nonetheless, I do anticipate, hopefully not too optimistically, that in the very near future, we really will have quite a lot of very useful data for investors, for managers, for lawyers, prime brokers, directors, etc., in providing information on how the fund governance business is really put together with real intelligence on both fund boards and on fund directors. And as we say here on this first slide, the information that we are gathering will allow managers to assess where they stand vis-a-vis their peers. And as we say in the bottom point on this slide here, we are looking at possibly ranking managers' fund board standards by various criteria, including by the use of independence. There's various different ways people use independence, and also by gender diversity, and doubtless by a number of other things too. It really is, what we're doing is really sort of a matrix of information that hasn't existed in this industry before. So the NED's Fund Governance Data Hub has two purposes. I've already effectively referred to one, which is intelligence on managers' fund boards by composition to determine capability, diversity, use of independence, and various other things along those lines. And then the second reason for doing it is to provide intelligence to fund board selectors and others on independent fund directors, including with their experience and qualifications on independence and capacity, which we'll be coming onto in a few minutes' time. Many of you coming on to this call today will have received the recently received the February issue of the NED, and this is covered in a lot more detail in the NED. And indeed, what's in the NED is it's only a summary of what we have in our databases, but there are people here today that aren't subscribers, so they may have not seen this at all. So we have analyzed so far 118 Cayman directors, and those 118 Cayman directors have 1,226 manager relationships, and they are on the boards of 4,357 funds or sub-funds. And the average Cayman director has 10.4 manager relationships and is on the boards of 40 funds or sub-funds. However, there's a very important caveat here, which is that this information I've just presented does not include funds that are registered, domiciled in Cayman that are not registered with the SEC, and nor does it include funds that are below the SEC's threshold limit, which I believe is $150 million. And I've had quite a number of conversations in the last few weeks on how many more that would be if you added those in as well. The estimations vary up to about even 50% of the market, but some people estimate it to be much less than that. The fact is absolutely nobody knows, and I'm sure not even probably Seema knows. No one knows, it's just guesswork, but it's clearly quite a lot more. So you could argue that the average Cayman director has definitely more manager relationships than 10.4 and is typically on the boards of somewhat more than 40 funds or sub-funds. Coming back to the SEC's form ADV, at least we know it's reliable, it's dependable, it's no one's going to be lying on that form and it's going to be accurate. So insofar as it goes, it's a very good analysis of the Cayman market. And indeed, it works well, reasonably well in some other jurisdictions as well too. These are the big three fund governance firms in Cayman, according to the data analysis that Olga particularly has done. And there you have the big three. Maples is the largest fund governance firm in Cayman, but that's because it has easily has the largest number of directors. I think in Cayman, probably elsewhere as well, but especially in Cayman, I think the key is manager relationships per director. And Khan has by quite comfortably the largest number of those. Khan has something like 16.4 manager relationships per director. And as you will have seen on the previous slide, the average in Cayman is 10.4. So that's more than both DMS and Maples and well above the average. In fact, it looks like Khan is over 50% in terms of their manager relationships per director above the average. I'm not sure that Khan's aware of that, but there it is. So as I said a few minutes ago, we just finished our first go round in Cayman. We will be coming back to Cayman. I know there's at least one and potentially more than one person on this call today. We didn't analyze their firms in Cayman. We will be coming back to that. So we will be hopefully picking up a couple of new firms that we've come across that have set up there too, a little bit later in the year. In the meantime, we are turning our attention to Europe, and the vast majority of people following this today are in Europe. We have at least one person and more than one person mostly in all these jurisdictions on the screen. We are coming your way very, very shortly. And we would love it if you would provide to us information on the funds you are on or the manager relationships that you have. We, of course, know very well not everyone is going to do that. And maybe not even the large numbers of people will do that. So we will also be analyzing the information that we are able to analyze from the regulated websites that are listed on the bottom of the screen too. And as a point that's probably worth mentioning in passing is that the form ADV from the SEC is actually not only good for Cayman or elsewhere in the Caribbean, it's also astonishingly good to a degree for Ireland and actually to a fair degree for Luxembourg. Of course, it doesn't cover everything, but there are surprisingly large number of funds in those jurisdictions and a few in the Channel Islands as well that are registered with the SEC. So that makes our life an awful lot easier. Of course, we'll be going into national regulators' websites too. Some are better than others. The CBI's ICAV register is great. That's very useful. And the GFSC and the JFSC also can provide us with quite a lot of useful information too. I'm now going to switch attention to the managers for a minute, because whilst we're doing the work on the directors, we're also at the same time in parallel doing work on managers. So far, and forgive me, because a few of you may have been on the last NED forum in late January where we did touch upon this, so apologies if you've seen this before. We've been doing analysis on fund boards from managers, from the data, from data sources I've just been referring to. We've done about 75 of the largest managers, alternative managers. We know there's a household name alternative managers to date. And of those 75 or so, those are the best 10 on the screen right now. And I'm going to give you a couple of examples of why. I could give you more, but for the sake of time, I'm just going to stick with two. Why we picked those 10. Example one will be Aries, which is a manager I don't really know at all, but they really have, really by the standards of these things, very good fund boards indeed. They have 40 funds in Cayman, one in Luxembourg. They have really quite considerable and impressive different use of independent directors from different fiduciary companies, principally three on the screen there, Maples, Orcarian, Astera, and TDO. And each, the majority of their funds have different directors on, independent directors on each time, which is very unusual anywhere, especially in Cayman, but they do. And they do, with their 41 funds, use 21 different independent directors, which I think is a very good sign. And we're also going to do this for gender diversity purposes too. So we're picking up information on females on boards. For 20 of their 41 boards have at least one woman, which is above the industry average. And their average board size is 2.6. A very different example, deliberately picked because it is so different, is Marshall Wace. They have 35 fund boards recorded by the SEC, all of which are in Ireland. In this case, they do use the same independent directors for all 35 funds, but they're all completely independent, unconnected. And we recognize these are some of the leading figures in the fund governance business in Ireland. They're pretty much all, if not all, well-known figures. And if you were an investor in those funds, you'd be confident in seeing those names if you knew anything about them. They, interestingly, even though all the funds are domiciled in Ireland, they have one resident director in Cayman, the rest are in Ireland. All their boards have one woman, and their average board size is 5. So I'm now going to give you two examples on the downside. Out of the 75, unfortunately, there were a number of managers whose funds didn't make what we would call the grade, and I'm probably better off at the moment, at least until we've spoken to them and asked them why they're doing what they're doing and the way they're doing it, have their names redacted, but you would know their names extremely well, very well-known managers. This is a very, very large global manager, the large office in London, originally from the US. It has 43 funds with boards recorded by the SEC in Luxembourg. Absolutely none of their funds has any non-executive independence on their board at all. They even have, which is very unusual, the person responsible for fund distribution sitting on the board. And if you look at the board composition, it just looks like an internal management company meeting. On the plus side, they do have two women on each board, and their average board size is 7. This is maybe continental Europe's largest manager, long only and alternative, very well-known name. They have 25 funds with boards recorded by the SEC in Cayman. None of these funds have any non-executive or independence on their boards at all. None of them have any women, and their average board size is 2.4. A couple of other observations quickly in passing. We came across another very well-known manager that really scores very well by all metrics that we can come up with for judging a fund board composition, with one blemish that they have, not on all their funds, but on a fair number of them, an independent director who was reprimanded by SEMA 2 years ago, and which is quite difficult to do, to get reprimanded by SEMA. Nonetheless, they do have that, and it does change our view of where they stand on this. And then a very well-known large hedge fund manager that, again, everyone on this call would know the name of very well, great performance. They use the same two independents on all 42 of their funds, irrespective of jurisdiction. They're mostly in the Caribbean, if it may all be in the Caribbean. And one of those two independent directors was mentioned in the Paradise Papers and is also involved in quite a sort of complicated and potentially gory looking case in the BVI. So again, blemishes there. So I'm now gonna move back onto the subject of what we're doing on the director side. Most people following this call today are on the director side. There's three pieces of criteria we have selected after our consultation with the industry in the summer of last year. for deciding on our director ratings. Experience, you have to have 10 years experience. On the subject of independence, we've used the criteria from the UK fund governance, sorry, not fund governance, the UK governance code. It's not actually funds, but the general governance code. But we've added something, which is that you cannot work for an organization offering other services to managers. And this is the key point, that are not differentiated into separate business areas. There are many firms that do differentiate what they do into different business areas, and that's absolutely fine as far as we're concerned. But if you work for one of those that doesn't, and your firm has a relationship with that manager in other areas outside, sitting on the board, even though it's not you personally, we don't think that is makes you sufficiently independent. And on capacity, we have, after a long barney with a bunch of people, particularly in debate, whatever you want to call it, with a lot of people in Cayman, we ended up, to save a lot of time, following the CBI's guidance. We thought, and that's based on a time itemization of directorships with a limit of 2,000 hours per year or 220 working days. Those who are subscribers, who reach the top echelon, according to the criteria I've just been through, and I understand a few people are using this now, can use this logo. Some people I understand are using on their emails. They can put it on their websites. They can do with it what they want. And it shows that, you know, there is an independent entity in us. We have no skin in the game. It doesn't make any difference to us whatsoever how people do their boards. But we've done the criteria in consultation with the industry. If you reach the green rated level, it's an assurance, I think, that you are of a certain standard and you're able, therefore, to use that. Why are we doing director ratings, you may ask? Because, as I perhaps just said, it provides investors and managers with validation from an objective source. We like to think we're an objective source, that a director is experienced, independent, and has sufficient capacity. And secondly, we very much hope, and it will help promote the cause of capable and professional independent directors, which I think is needed at the moment for various reasons we don't have time to go into. But I think as we get further into this decade, I think that is important. But at the end of the day, just giving people a sort of kite mark, to use an expression from English, it's for white goods in England, if you have a washing machine or a fridge, you get a kite mark on it to show it's past a certain level. Our green rated director is supposed to be doing the same thing as that. I've been talking all about the green just now. Quickly, the yellow and the red. The yellow would simply mean that you perhaps fail in one area, whether it be capacity or experience, or you might not have enough experience, or you are not independent according to the criteria that I've just previously outlined. Red, we know very few people who would be in the red category. There are, we do know, one or two, though, that are in the red category and are, as I've already intimated on this in this presentation, active in the market today, who would be in that red category for the reasons I've already outlined. Finally, we're putting all this as well as into a data hub. We are also developing, and it goes beyond the fund governance side of our business into Manco's, into various other areas, we're developing this thing called Selection Intelligence Service, which is advice for managers, investors and their advisors on fund director selection, domicile selection, Manco selection. And that information is free for subscribers to any of our publications. The moment it's being used probably more by people looking for advice on Manco, third-party Manco selection in places like Ireland and Luxembourg, but it has been used, and I'm sure it will be used more in the future for those looking for information on directors too. Before we get into questions, hopefully we'll have some questions. This is our 10th anniversary year. What are our plans beyond publishing the publication, as always, which it's a lot of work is going into something we should have done this years ago, but better late than never. We're trying to develop this objective analysis of fund governance standards with benchmarking capabilities for the industry that we hope will be a big advance for the industry at large. We're starting for our subscribers to do Zoom interviews with them so they can put that on our website. We can put it on our website, which we'll be revising quite soon. And at the moment, sadly, of course, they're only online, but we'll be doing an awful lot of both online and when we can, physical events, especially in New York, as well as in London and perhaps elsewhere in the latter part of the year. So that's enough for me. I see that we do have actually some questions, Olga. I'm just going to stop sharing screen and then perhaps we can go to questions. Right. Okay.
We have a few questions and let me start with the first one then. How will you benchmark managers' fund boards?
How will we benchmark managers' fund boards? Well, it's not going to be, we're in the process of working that one out as we speak. It's not going to be a simple X is better than Y. I think it will be by different criteria. So we've already done, I don't know who asked that question, but they may or may not have seen, we did, I think it was the January issue of the NED. We did, not a benchmarking, but we published information we had on gender diversity of boards, according to the information we have, which varies very considerably. There's some managers with quite good female representation on them, but about 40% have no female representation at all. So that's one bit of criteria. That, and so you can see how you, and there's a grading, of course, from the best down to the worst on gender diversity, but then also use of independence. It's not just a number, I think it's the way they're use will be another way of doing that. Experience could be another. We're gathering all this information now. As I say, I don't think there's going to be one simple overall number that you can quickly come to, but you will be able to come to us, and indeed you can come to us already now, and you can say, give me IFI Global the information on gender diversity of international alternative asset managers fund boards, and we can press a button and provide that. Or a use of independence, or whatever it may be. Hopefully that's the best answer I can give to that particular question.
Okay, the second one is more of a comment. You said in last month's issue of the NED that Cayman is not transparent, but you seem to have a lot of information from there, so maybe it is. Shade.
fair enough. No, well, the best answer to that question is we do have a reasonable amount of information from there, but not, there is some of it actually that does come from the director firms directly in Cayman, but most of it does not. Most of it comes from, thanks to Olga, comes from going through databases, particularly the ADV, SEC's form ADV. And we have, I hope Olga doesn't mind me saying this, a few scars on our back from having gone through that process, because we went to 24 fund governance firms in Cayman and said, look, we've got this information on you. Can you verify it's accurate? Because we're not going to publish this level of detail in the NED, but we are going to publish a summary of it. And I may as well be totally honest. We got a few angry reactions, didn't we, Olga? They didn't particularly like that. They don't like that information being published. It's completely accurate, assuming the form ADV's SEC information is accurate, that they would prefer that we would leave them alone and didn't publish that. So I don't think, although yes, we do, it's correct to say, we do have quite a lot of information now from Cayman, but, and it is, and there are some absolutely great honorable exceptions, some great fund governance firms who were really fabulous at helping us in what we were doing. And thank you to them. I think if two or three of them or more even are following us today. So thank you. This is not everybody in Cayman at all, but there were some people who, let's put it like this, didn't like our attention. And I have to say, and it's not the first time we've written about, that's why we wrote that article about transparency or the back of it in Cayman. At a time when Cayman is looking, the European Parliament is looking, has just put a big vote food blacklist Cayman again. I don't think, hopefully that will happen, because it's not their decision, it goes to the European Council. But just in the last few days since I wrote the article, I see the FATF has grey-listed Cayman, put it on its watch list. I think Cayman should be in areas where it can be transparent, where it makes no difference to its, it's not, there are no downsides to its transparency. It should be as transparent as possible. It should get all the friends it could get. And so, sorry for that long answer to that question, but sorry to get that off my chest, but I thought it was an opportunity to do so. And okay, I see there's one more question at least. Yeah.
There's one more question. How does the tailored shortlist from your director database work?
How does the tailored shortlist from that database work? Yeah, that's a good question. I should have perhaps spent a bit longer explaining that. The way it works is as follows. First of all, I'll tell you how it doesn't work. We're never going to, or at least for the time being, meaning at least this year probably, we're not going to be providing a full list of all the people who are in our green list, which by the way, is also the NED's recommended list of directors. We'll say to the market, these people we've checked, these people all pass the criteria that we've been through this afternoon in this presentation. So we think they're all good. So please pick one from there. We're not gonna do that. What we are gonna do is we've done this actually very, very informally for many years. I've had the odd call from time to time from people saying, we're looking for somebody who's got experience in emerging market debt, who might know something about Latin America or whatever it may be. Can you recommend someone? So what we will now do is pick out anybody from our database that meets the criteria that the person asking the question has asked. We will put that selector in touch with, say, whatever it is, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, right? Depends on how specialized the search is as to how many people we have in that criteria. And I should add that for that reason, we want everyone in there we can possibly get, whether they are a subscriber or not. It's very much in our interest to have that database as complete as possible. The subscribers are the ones that can benefit from the commercial perspective in terms of using the logo I just referred to and other things. And we will probably, if we get everything else is equal, advantage our subscribers where we can, but we want it to be a really comprehensive database as well. That's probably the best way of answering that particular question. That's it. I've managed to answer them with just about 2 minutes to go onto the half hour. So I think unless we've got any more questions, we may be done. So thank you all. I'll just say thank you all for joining us this afternoon. We'll be doing these things very regularly, and we'll have many more updates on the information that we provided. If you're in the European domiciles, we will be in touch with you very shortly for the reasons I've just mentioned. So probably as soon as next week. And we will begin continuing to develop our manager side as well. So it is all coming together. As I said already, I wish we'd done this years ago, but better late than never. And hopefully what we're doing will be a benefit to the industry at large. So have a good, if you're in Cayman or the States, have a good morning. If you're in Europe, have a good afternoon and evening, and hopefully see you the next time. Bye-bye, everybody.
Yeah, bye-bye, everyone.